And we're here in Africa House. I'm an artist. I have my studio here and also a gallery. And I'm now 78 and have lived a long and rich and varied life with many experiences. And I want to thank Angel for making this movie of Lord, Plant My Feet on Higher Ground. Lord, Plant My Feet on Higher Ground was painted in 1993. I first conceived it in 1982. And that was the year when I was at the Virginia Center of the Creative Arts as a fellow. I had been painting individuals, African-American individuals in Lynchburg, individually. But I realized that I was a slow painter, and the significance of the leaders that I was painting would be lost if I waited until I had done them all individually. So that was how the concept of putting everybody together on a large triptych, showing all at least 75 people, named people, who were active in Lynchburg, Virginia, during the 1960s and 70s, during the civil rights movement, and put them all together on one painting with places and institutions in the background that were significant to those times. That inspiration came to me, and a group formed around me, Junius Haskins, Garnell Stamps, and Hayward Robinson, to help me identify the people, and they showed me pictures of how they looked in those times, even though I knew most of them. And so I painted it in 1993. There are three panels that portray those significant local people and those places and events. And the left-hand panel shows mainly the young people and the more radical types that were necessary for the movement to go forward. In the central panel, the major leaders, and they are all marching down from the churches and other significant landmarks that meant so much to spur the movement on. And on the right-hand panel are the more conservative ones and the physicians and educators, and all were necessary for this movement to go on. There are also people who are not named, who I didn't know, but everybody played a part in this movement for civil rights and integration. The a lot of the major events were the integration of the Patterson's drugstore was one of them, the sit-ins there. I know they were done in Greensville and other places around the country, but here in Lynchburg we also had sit-ins. And at that time, Lynchburg, of course, like most southern cities, was segregated officially by law, and so these African Americans, mainly students, who and there were a few white college students who sat in with them, had to go to jail because they were breaking the law. There also the integration of the swimming pools in 1962. a group led by Olivet Thaxton of young African-American boys and girls went to Millipark's swimming pool and tried to do a wade-in. Well, the reaction of the authorities was to immediately close the pool, and they subsequently filled in all the swimming pools in the city, and they weren't opened for some time, several years later. So there were many stories told on that painting, and through this video, this film, some of those stories hopefully will be told, because even though in the history books we will see or hear about Dr. Martin Luther King, who was and the other major national leaders in the country, they would not have had any movement had it not been for cities, towns, people throughout the country, particularly throughout the South, like Lynchburg, where their own courageous people stood up and marched and were strong enough to rebel against the authorities, to press onward for civil rights. And this is what this painting is trying to portray, that people who were ordinary people, they were school teachers, they were workmen, they were doctors, they were lawyers, they were housewives, young people, students. They realized that the law was very inequitable, that it was an unjust law, and they put their lives on the line. They were courageous, and they didn't know when they went out into the streets and protested what the reprisals would be. Lynchburg, fortunately, there was no major violence, but in neighboring cities like Danville, there were riots and fires, and other cities also. But Lynchburg, due to excellent leadership in the black community and some in the white community, was able to remain calm. And but nobody knew when they spoke up and stepped forward to protest these unjust laws, what the reprisals would be. Lynchburg at that time was a very racist community. We had a newspaper that had a very racist policy. They, at one period, did not print anything at all about the black high school, Dunbar High School here. The weddings, the obituaries, they didn't print African-American obituaries. Any job vacancies, they were all listed, either white or black. But not only that, the whole tone of the newspaper, there was nothing reported that was favorable to the black community that was printed in the newspaper. And only if somebody was arrested, their picture was then put in the paper, if they were black. And so it was, the climate here was very oppressive if you were African American. For instance, I wrote a paper in 1977 on racism. This was a paper I was doing for my master's degree with George Washington University on institutional racism. And I'll just quote from a part of it. Consider further the case of Thomas Wansley at Lynchburg, Virginia. In the winter of 1962, he was 17 years old. He was accused of raping two women, one white, the other Japanese, and of stealing $1.36 from one of the victims. The white woman was unable to identify Wansley. The police, after a private talk with Wansley, were able to obtain a confession. The Japanese woman positively identified Wansley. The youth testified that he had had sexual relations with her on several occasions. The all-white jurors handed down two death sentences for rape and a 20-year prison term for the $1.36 robbery. Wansley is a black man. 3 months before, in the same court, a white man had received a 5-year sentence for raping an 11-year-old Negro girl. The white man served 6 months of his sentence and was released. Wansley is still in jail. That was in 1977. The Virginia Supreme Court voided the death sentences as a trial error. There was a retrial in 1967, resulting in a sentence to life imprisonment. Subsequent attempts to obtain Wansley's release, retrial, or governor's pardon have been met with refusal. Wansley still maintains his innocence. Over the years, more than 450 black men have been executed in Virginia for allegedly raping white women. No white men have been executed for the same crime against a black woman. That shows a bit the tone or the flavor of things in Lynchburg. And it's not that as a white person you realize that those things are happening all the time. My family and I were living in Lynchburg, very nice, and we were trying to adapt to the environment here. And it was difficult, but we realized when in Rome do as Rome does, and it was a segregated community. So where I drank out, if I ever drank out of a water fountain, I would go to the whites-only water fountain or the whites-only toilets, and things like that. And I was busy raising my little babies and didn't think too much about it. Until I would go to St. John's Episcopal Church. I was brought up as an Anglican, and that was my church. And through Evelyn Stickley, who was a member of the church, she was asking for people to who might like to volunteer and do things in the community. So Lynchburg Community Action Group had been formed here to work with the poverty program. And so I said, well, yes, I would go on a tour and see what was happening, thinking a whole group of St. John's folk were there. Well, I was the only one who showed up. And anyway, Evelyn took me around, and I went to Darrington to the well, they call it the projects here. It was a place that was 100% African-American, pretty much 100% female-headed households, and of course a lot of children, and it's still there at Darrington. And I was there, and Bertha Dickerson was the agent there from Lynchburg Community Action Group. And she said she had a group of, she followed up. I said, well, I would help if there was something I could do. I said, I'm not particularly talented, but that I did do art. So she called me up and said, would you come and give art classes? So I came and to Darrington, and I would go on Saturday mornings. And there was a bunch of young people there, children. But I realized, even though the city had these recreation facilities for the what they call the inner city, all that was there was a large room, one ping pong table, one small other table, and a sink that didn't work very well, and a closet that had no shelves in it. And anyway, I would bring supplies and paper and paint and pencils and glue and stuff like that, and that I gathered from people at the church, and would give these classes. Well, the children were very creative and very excited, and that was my introduction to the world of African American people here. And because the races were pretty much separate, and so people said, well, that's the way it is, and they are happy there and we are happy here. And then there was this prejudice, well, these are just welfare mothers and they're ignorant and don't care about their children. And there was this prejudice, and they're the maids and the janitors and people like that. Well, I was there and I had a couple of helpers, women helpers. Well, there was Bertha Dickerson, and then Jeanette Franklin, and then Louise Johnson. And they helped me there. And I got to know these women, and they were very intelligent. I enjoyed their company. And so I gradually realized that those prejudices were totally incorrect. And this Louise Johnson, was one of my helpers, I was told after a few weeks that she had been jailed but had been released right now pending trial for murder of an infant, her infant. Well, I was totally astounded at this, and found out that Louise, who lived in the projects at Darrington, or had two children who came to my classes, and her husband was in jail, and she was pregnant, and was at home. The children had gone to school. She did not have a telephone, and she delivered her baby, and it was stillborn. Well, and she sort of, I suppose, passed out or something. But anyway, she recovered and laid out the child and washed herself and everything, and managed to call through the window to one of the neighbors, who came, found the baby there that was dead, had been stillborn. Well, then the authorities came and took her off to jail. And I was just so astounded, because I thought, well, if she'd been a white woman, certainly, you know, a middle class woman, and people I knew, that would never have happened, that somebody in that condition would be thought of as actually killing their child. And so I don't know what actually happened in the end. I'm sure she was exonerated. But these were experiences that really opened my eyes to what the situation was, that a lot of the inequities here. And But anyway, I was going along my own way here, and then our children were growing up, and we had two more children, and our house was getting a little small for us, so we put it on the market. Well, there was a slump at that time, and we didn't sell it right away, and we rented it out for a year. But then we really needed to sell it. And so it was advertised, we put it through a realtor. And then, this was in 1968. And at that time, it was quite legal in Virginia to discriminate, to not sell your property to African Americans or people of another race. In fact, even have clauses in your deed that they would never be resold. And of course, it was customary also not to sell to African Americans. And anyway, the realtor said that somebody wanted to buy, and I had a reasonable offer for the property. The property is on the corner of Cleveland and Magnolia Streets in Lynchburg, and that it happened to be a black person. It was Hazel Bulware, Dr. Bulware, and his wife, who wanted to buy the property. So I, of course, was aware of the racial situation in my neighborhood. I had elderly neighbors and didn't want to upset them too much. They had grown up in this segregated system. And I spoke to them and said I had this offer. And but then we decided to accept the offer and sold it to the Bulwares, who, knowing that they were actually fronting for another family, but we knew who they were. It was the Jones family, who still lived in that house. But anyway, we sold the property. And as soon as the neighbors found out, well, of course, in the neighborhood found out, and different people found out that we had done that, we received a lot of threatening telephone calls, harassing telephone calls. And it was disturbing, not so much for my husband and myself, but I was afraid that the children would pick up the telephone and hear all this nasty talk, and I was frightened of that. I was also concerned that they might be harassed at school or on their way to school, because there were elements in the community that had this violent streak in them. But nothing like that happened, but we did have those nasty telephone calls. And also, we had decided, since now we were living there, that there was a country club down the street, the Oakwood Country Club, not too far away. And my husband, by the way, is a professional engineer with General Electric, with a master's degree and everything. So we applied for the membership in the Oakwood Country Club, and received a letter saying that we were not acceptable as members. And I found out from members of the country club that the reason was that we had sold a house to a black family. So I suppose that they were so concerned if we did that, that heaven knows we might bring black families or our friends into the club, or I don't know what they were afraid of, but that was a bit of a shock to me that that something like that would happen in Lynchburg, which is has a veneer of culture and nice living, but Christianity. So I think that those sort of things made me a little more aware of just what the climate is or was here in Lynchburg. We have changed. Not completely, we still have a while far to go, but things have changed. Because Oakwood Country Club, at that time, now this was in the late 60s, but in 69, well, I regress a little because I don't know that Dr. R. Walter Johnson, who is on the painting, African-American doctor, he had coached Althea Gibson and Arthur Ashe on his tennis court on Pierce Street. They subsequently became Wimbledon champions, but they were not allowed on any of the public tennis courts in Lynchburg or any of the country club courts. In 1969, Dr. Johnson petitioned Oakwood Country Club to allow African Americans to participate in the Virginia tennis tournament that was held there every year or something. And they said, well, don't rock the boat this year. We'll do it next year. We'll open it to them. Well, of course, the African American community have been used to these promises that were never fulfilled, because in 1975, they still hadn't opened it to African Americans, because a young boy, friend of my son's, Ricky, his last name now, who is now a prominent surgeon, or a prominent physician up in Massachusetts, wanted to play in that tennis tournament and was denied, a young African American. And so they are open now, of course, to African Americans, but it took a lot of struggle and rejection to get things going. Of course, private clubs certainly can have can choose their membership, but it is indicative of the feeling here. For instance, when my daughter was married in 87 or something like that, she wanted to have her wedding reception at Boonesburg Country Club. But when we found out that no blacks were allowed as guests, and that's in 1987, we of course chose not to have it there. But these things, I don't know, there are a lot of stories, and I'm glad you were putting them into your film, Angel, because otherwise they're easily forgotten. You won't find it in the history books. And these indignities that were suffered by African Americans, or Negroes as they were called then. For instance, they would go to the stores downtown, and if they saw a dress or something that they would like, they were not allowed to try them on, because then they said, well, nobody would want to try on something afterwards. you know, no white person would want to try it on after they had tried it on. So they're not allowed to try on things. The dignity of having the sign, you have to sit in the back of the bus. Being treated as lesser than human. And this was in a country that we had come to, that we saw as a beacon of liberty and equality and justice. To see this happening here was really very painful. Here we were, we had decided to come to this country, they were not living, America was not living up to its creed as we saw it. And of course, when you're a foreigner and coming into a country, you see things differently than when you're living there all the time. And so it was probably easier for us to notice these differences, or they were just inequities, or they just discordant things. And there were a lot of eye-openers. Like in Lynchburg, not many white folk spoke out or stepped forward. There were some exceptions to this. The majority of the white churches kept silent. They were afraid that their own membership might leave. Or many of them, like Thomas Rowe, firmly believed in the separation of races. They believed that that was ordained in the Bible. And but there were exceptions to that. And Bev Cosby, I must say something about Bev. He was from an old Lynchburg family, and he established the Church of the Covenant here. And the Church of the Covenant was a small church, but they were dedicated to in service to the people. And they had a coffee house that was open to blacks and whites, and people could go and exchange ideas there. They also, this was off Boonesboro Road, they also had a swimming pool there. And when the city's swimming pools were closed, they opened their pool to the African American community. And I know that Dr. Wesley's children and some others, you know, came over to swim. And it was not a very large pool, but several African Americans came. And some from the camp Kumbaya would come. So when they came, Bev got messages from the whites in the neighborhood who had been using the pool, asking him to drain the water out of his pool after the black children had swum in it, because they didn't want their children presumably contaminated by water from the black children. Now, that seems bizarre in this day and age. But that was indicative of the climate of the time. White folk did not want to swim with it. With black children, did not want them to drink out of the same water fountain, did not want them to try on clothes. And yet, they hired black folk to look after their babies, look after their children, to clean their homes, cook their food. It was just a totally bizarre arrangement, I think. But anyway, that was the way it was. And fortunately, we have come some distance from that, but not without a struggle. And that is what the painting, Lord Plant My Feet on Higher Ground, hopes to commemorate, so that people won't forget that there were people who were courageous enough to stand up and be counted in those days.
So, Anne, would you go into a little detail about the man who lost his business?
Yes. Oliver Thaxton. Oliver Thaxton was the man who led the young people to integrate the swimming pool at Miller Park. And he also participated with the NAACP and other things. His business was, he had like a trucking business, a delivery business, and he did most of his business for Patterson's drugstore. So when, after the sit-ins occurred, and after the Pattersons realized that Oliver Thaxton was instrumental and active in the civil rights movement, they withdrew the patronage of his business. And I think some other white companies also did that. And so he lost his business. Now, a lot of the people who were active, Africans, Americans who were active in civil rights, were not as dependent on the white community for their income. And for instance, people like T.D. Thornhill, who had a funeral home, community funeral home, he was dependent on the African-American community. The doctors were dependent on the African-American community. The people who were employed as teachers, there was also, you know, people, if they went too far, they could lose it. But people like Garnell Stamps, who was very outspoken and a protagonist for civil rights, was a school teacher. He could have lost his job if the authorities had tried to manufacture some reason for it. But he was an excellent teacher, they couldn't manufacture any reason for it, so he kept his job. But none of them knew whether they would lose their job or not. And so it did take courage to do things like that, to stand up and be counted. Was there anybody else that you think I should speak about?
I think I was very interested in the story of the house being sold, but I think you covered that pretty much, because that was very new to me.
Mm-hmm. There of course were many other stories in conjunction with the painting, and hopefully everybody will tell their story, and it won't be forgotten, and it probably takes more than time we have right now. Of course, it was just a period. It was the 60s and the 70s. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground means that people had already, they'd moved from slavery through Reconstruction, through the Jim Crow, and they were in the Jim Crow area with the segregation. And of course the segregation of schools, the law, you know, Virginia was a massive resistance state. A neighboring townie, they closed all their schools rather than integrate. All the public schools were closed for several years. And Lynchburg became under court order, and they did integrate, but it wasn't without a struggle. It was supposed to be separate but equal, but the schools were not equal, the facilities were not equal, Ann Spencer, who became the librarian at Dunbar High School, the school board did not provide a library for Dunbar, the black high school. And so the segregated Jones Memorial Library sponsored the Dunbar High School Library and sponsored her. So it was a very strange system, very strange. A lot of those schools, the black schools, were closed and torn down. Yoda School, that had been established by Jacob Yoda, or established during the time of Jacob Yoda and named for him. He came as a Mennonite right after the Civil War and started schools here. That was closed, torn down. Dunbar High School, before whites were allowed to come in there, they redid the whole playing grounds and everything like that, and upgraded it. It became a junior high school. It was a struggle. It was, and a lot of the children, whites and blacks, it was a big adjustment that had to be made. And changing over from this system of segregation to a more integrated system.
And I was wondering if you could talk about your childhood in Africa, because your background is so unique with regard to this African-American
maybe
woman,
thank you.
You know?
Well, yes, I think maybe my whole life has led up to coming to Lynchburg. And I was born in Africa, which is why I call this place Africa House. I always wanted to go back. And my parents, my mother was from South Africa. My father was English. His name was George Rushby. My mother's name was Eleanor Dunbar Leslie. And she came from several generations in South Africa. And she, in fact, one of her ancestors was Dr. John Phillips, who was very instrumental in abolishing slavery in South Africa, in emancipation. And he was a Presbyterian minister, head of the Presbyterian Church in South Africa. And but another of my mother's ancestors on her mother's side was a de Villiers, and the de Villiers were slave owners. So she came from both emancipation and the slave owner background. My father was British. He came to Africa in 1918, right after the First World War, as a young adventurer, and he landed in Mozambique and was hired to provide meat for people building the railroad from Mozambique, from Beira into the interior of Africa. So he became a hunter, and then he became a professional elephant hunter. And he traveled all over Africa on foot, and did many adventurous things. He was in the Congo, he was in, but mainly in East Africa. And he contracted black water fever, which is a very severe form of malaria, and went to England to recuperate. Well, he had written some articles about elephant hunting, and my mother, who was a school teacher in South Africa, had read these articles, and they had set up a correspondence. So they fell in love through writing to each other. And when he came from England, he stopped off in Cape Town, where my mother was living, and they met and got engaged within a few weeks and to be married. So, of course, my grandfather, who was a magistrate and very proper and everything, thought this was very extraordinary and rather wild thing to do, but my father said, well, he was going to buy some property and set up a coffee farm in East Africa, and that my mother could follow, they would get married and settle down. He would no longer travel around as an elephant hunter. So that transpired, and they were married in Dar es Salaam, in Tanganyika, which was then Tanganyika. And in 1930. And she wrote letters to her parents religiously, and she was a lovely writer. So I'll read just a little about her experiences in what was then known as Tanganyika. And this is, she's writing, "Dearest family, well, here we are at our country seat, Mchewe Estate. But I'll start at the beginning of our journey and describe the farm later. The farm was my first home. We left the hotel at Dar es Salaam for the station in a taxi crowded with luggage, and at the last moment, Cath Wood ran out with the unwrapped bottom layer of our wedding cake. It remained in its naked state from there to here, traveling for 2 days on the train, on the luggage rack, for 4 days in the car, on my knee, reposing at night on the roof of the car, exposed to the winds of heaven, and now rests beside me in the tent, looking like an old, old tombstone. We have no tin large enough to hold it, and one simply can't throw away one's wedding cake. So, as George does not eat cake, I can see myself eating wedding cake for tea for months to come, aunts permitting. We traveled up by train from Dar to Dodoma, first through the bush vegetation of the coastal belt to Morogoro, then through sisal plantations, now very overgrown with weeds, owing to the slump in prices, and then on to the arid area around Dodoma. This part of the country is very dry at this time of the year, and not unlike parts of our Karoo. The train journey was comfortable enough, but slow, as the engines here are fed with wood and not coal, as in South Africa. Dodoma is the nearest point on the railway to Mbeya, so we left the train there to continue our journey by road. We arrived at the one and only hotel in the early hours, and whilst someone went to rout out the night watchman, the rest of us sat on the dismal veranda amongst a litter of broken glass. Some bright spark remarked upon the obvious that there must have been a party the night before. When we were shown to a room, I thought I rather preferred the veranda because the beds had not yet been made up, and there was a bucket of vomit beside the old-fashioned washstand. However, George soon got the boys to tidy up the room, and I fell asleep to be awakened by George with the invitation to come and see our car before breakfast. Yes, we have our own car. It is a Chev with what is called a box body. That means that sides, roof, and doors are made by a local Indian carpenter. There's just the one front seat with a kapok mattress on it. The tools are kept in a sort of cupboard fixed to the side, so there is a big space for carrying safari kit behind the cab seat. Lamech, who had traveled up on the same train, appeared after breakfast and helped George to pack all our luggage into the back of the car. Besides our suitcases, there was a huge bedroll, kitchen utensils, and a box of provisions, tins of petrol and water, and all Lamech's bits and pieces, which included 3 chickens in a wicker cage and an enormous bunch of bananas about 3 feet long. When all these things were packed, there remained only a small space between goods and ceiling, and into this Lamech squeezed. He lay on his back, with his feet a mere inch or so from the back of my head. In this way, we traveled 400 miles over bumpy earth roads and crude pole bridges. But whenever we stopped for a meal, Lamech wiggled out and, like Aladdin's genie, produced good meals in no time at all. In the afternoon, we reached a large river called the Ruaha. Workmen were busy building a large bridge across it, but it is not yet ready, so we crossed by a ford below the bridge. George told me that the river was full of crocodiles, but though I looked hard, I did not see any. This is also elephant country, but I did not see any of those either, only piles of dropping on the road. I must tell you that the natives around these parts are called Wahehe, and the river is Waha, enough to make a cat laugh. We saw some Wahehe out hunting with spears and bows and arrows. They live in long, low houses with the tiniest shuttered windows and rounded roofs covered with earth. Near the river, we also saw a few Maasai herding cattle. They are rather terrifying to look at, rather tall and very aloof. They wear nothing but a blanket knotted on one shoulder, and all carried 1 or 2 spears apiece. The road climbs steeply on the far side of the Ruaha, and one has the most tremendous view over the plains. We spent our first night up there in the high country. Everything was taken out of the car. The bedroll opened up, and George and I slept comfortably in the back of the car, whilst Lamech, rolled in blanket, slept soundly by a small fire nearby. So, I just wanted to say something like that to give you a description of the country as it was when I was a small child in Mbeya, or on the, our farm in Cherry. And I had a wonderful childhood. We were pretty isolated, as you can see from, or imagine from my mother's description of the place. There were monkeys in the trees behind the house. The house was built out of mud brick, had a veranda and thatched roof. And my mother looked after us, and we had the coffee farm with trees growing and banana trees down the road. And but it was really way out in the bush. There were Africans everywhere. I mean, we had workmen there, and there were children. But I never saw another white child except for my brother George, until I was 3 years old. And so I've always had a feeling of trust and belonging with Africans, with dark people. And I think that has stayed with me all my life. I think your childhood experiences affect you for the rest of your life. And I remember the head man, Thomas, would come in the mornings, and as a small child, I still remember him bringing some little red wine berries in a cone of a leaf, very green leaf, made into a cone and pinned with a thorn, and there were these red berries, and he would say, "Jambo," which is, you know, "Jambo," and, or "Good morning," and they present George and me with these little cones of berries in the morning. And so I have lovely memories like that. And unfortunately, my brother got typhoid and was very sick. And the doctor said that we had to go to Europe if we were, and I was apparently also not very strong, and had to go to Europe. And at that time, it was 1938, and my grandmother came out from England and took us back to England. And that was quite a contrast for us. I remember how cold it was. We arrived in January or February. My birthday was in February, and I remember when I was 6 years old, I remember seeing snow for the first time, and I remember the grayness and the houses all close together. But I went to school, and then, of course, the war broke out in 1939. We lived in Jacksdale, which was a small mining village in the Midlands, and went to the local school, went to the local village school, and the war broke out. So we were not an industrial city, so we were not the target for bombs, but we could hear the German bombers coming over to bomb Birmingham and Coventry, and they would come over and you would hear them, and then they would drop their bombs, and then they would come back and they would be a different sound. I still remember the air raid sirens that we would have to go in the air raid shelters, that we would carry gas masks. Every day you had to be prepared for us being gassed. We had blackout all the time. We had severe rationing. We had, we were always prepared for invasion. All the signposts were taken down so that any Germans coming wouldn't know their way around. A whole lot of different precautions and a fair amount of fear, I suppose, or danger, a feeling of danger, though my grandmother provided very well for us and just had pretty much normal childhood, but there was this overarching feeling of danger. And also at the end of the war, seeing those pictures of the concentration camps, they are just etched on my memory. And I think the feeling of genocide that was produced then, or the oppression of one people for another a branch of the human race, was etched on me then, in the horror of that. And then at the end of the war, my parents came and took me back again, George and me, and we went back to Africa. And so I was once again reunited with family that had grown by that time to include three more boys, my sister, so there are six children. And we went to boarding school there. I went to boarding school. And I think all this time, of course, I'd been, Tanganyika was a colony. Well, it was not a colony, it was a protectorate. It was not a colony like Kenya. There were only about 2% white folk there. The rest were black. There was separation of races there. It was a little different than in Africa than it was when I came to the United States. It was separate, but it was the African's country. And they had their language, they had their clothes, their dress. Well, they still had their traditional dress. There were others, some who dressed European dress, but and particularly those who had been went to mission schools, things like that. But there were still, in those days, the traditional culture of the villages and the chief, and they kept their traditions. There was also quite a large Indian population, and they were also pretty much kept to themselves, and they fulfilled a sort of merchant role. They had a lot of the shops, things like that. And so it was a very stratified society. So we were back in Africa together, the whole family. My father, my mother, my brother, myself, I'm the oldest of the family, George, my sister Kate, my brother John, Jim, and Henry. And it was so wonderful having the family all together. And even though I had reached high school age, it was sort of the middle of term. So I was sent to the local boarding school, which was just a preparatory school, Umbear School, to get me used to the idea of being at a boarding school. And it was very enjoyable being back together as a family and being back in Africa again. I loved the countryside there. I loved the browns, the colors of the surroundings, the vegetation, Umbear Mountain, the back there. We were a bit isolated. We were out in the country in a mud, again, in a mud brick house with a tin roof, but it was really wonderful, and we had servants. Now, in Africa, the races were kept separate pretty well, and our servants were all black. We had a cook, we had a cook's helper, we had a gardener, we had what they called a houseboy who did all the cleaning in the house, and I think a couple of other servants. I can't remember, they seem back alone. Now my parents were very insistent that as children we treat the servants with respect, that we do not give the servants orders, that they are adults. So that was my parents' way of doing things. It was not always the case in Africa, and some children treated the servants with disrespect, but we were taught the servants are adults, and as children, you do not order them about. The same thing was true in the school system there. The children in the schools could not give orders to any of the African servants. So the race situation was different in Africa than it is in the United States or Europe. It was Africans, it was their country, and they had their traditions. Some were Christian, but at that time I think there was still a majority had the traditional religions and customs. Lived in villages. There was a village not far away from our house, and at night we could hear the drummings of the when they had the gatherings there in Gomas. The Africans had their own tribal languages, but they also spoke Swahili. And we spoke Swahili when we were speaking to the Africans, but I've forgotten all my Swahili now. And it was a very wonderful time in my life. We were not rich by any means. We had six children. We did have indoor plumbing, but no electricity, no radio, no newspapers. My father would go into the office to work in Umbeya, So he would bring the mail out. Anyway, at the school was whites only, and but there were a lot of Greek children there. And I think still a couple of Germans. Tanganyika had been German East Africa before it was made a protectorate under the United Nations. And but a lot of my friends were Greek. My best friend was Athena Tonaridis, also Lula Psiloglu, and June Caligaris, and Venus Caligaris. They were great friends. And when I went to high school in Nairobi, there was no high school for white children in the whole of Tanganyika. So we went to Nairobi. And that meant doing a trip, sometimes took 5 days, sometimes took 10 days, depending on how the trains and the boat ran. And these trips were the best part of my life, I thought, because that was the freedom. First we would get on what they called the bus, but it was really like a big truck or something. And you would ride through Chunya to Itigi, and then you would be by the railroad and wait there in the rest house until the train came by. I think there were two trains a week going towards Mwanza, which was on Lake Victoria. And so we would wait in Itigi, and when the train came by, we would board it. Now the trains were wood burning trains still. This was in the late 40s, about 1948. And they would burn wood and have to stop every now and again to take on water and more wood. And at that time you would see the villagers coming up to the trains and selling little artifacts and things like that. And then we would stop at Mwanza on the Lake Victoria and wait there for the boat. There was a boat that went around Lake Victoria. I think Lake Victoria is the largest inland lake in the world. But there were two steamers that went around Lake Victoria, one clockwise, one anticlockwise. And we would wait for the boat. And on the train and on the boats, there were also the other children going to school. So the Greek girls were very good at dancing, and when we were on the boat, we would play records and dance and on the deck. And then we would stop off until we got to Kampala and Entebbe, and then catch the train there to go to Nairobi. And so those were times of freedom and going through the most beautiful country in the world, I think. And Africa then, and I think probably still now, as you were traveling, you could see herds of elephant. You saw kudu, you saw all kinds of antelope, giraffe, zebra. And this wonderful feeling of freedom, of not seeing fences, of seeing space. And I'd been used to England, where everything was fenced in and small and gray skies. And here was this wonderful feeling of freedom in Africa. Boarding school was not so free. We had very strict English upbringing and had to wear uniforms and even a tie and gray flannel skirts right on the equator. And a pretty strict regimen, but it was okay. And anyway, after I got my school certificate, I went to England to university, and there I studied chemistry and zoology, physics, and did fine until my final exams. And in England, at the university, if you don't pass your final exams, that's it, even if you've gotten far enough. And so I failed my finals and decided I wanted to see something of Europe before I went back to Africa. And at the university, I knew my friend Tony from Dalston. Tony was Dutch, and she had been incarcerated. Her family had been in Java, and during the war, she had spent a lot of her childhood in a Japanese concentration camp. So she was a little older than some of us, but anyway, she was a good friend of mine. And the upshot of it was that I did go to Holland. I was thinking of going to France and working as au pair. So I went to Holland and worked in the family. Well, the only job I could get was either with a circus or au pair or with an embassy, but since I didn't have any typing, I couldn't get a job at an embassy, and I couldn't work in a circus. So I looked after a child and a family, and got exposed to the Dutch culture. Now, I thought I'd had a pretty broad background. I had lived in Africa, I had lived in England, and but I realized that those had both been very British. Africa was a colony, and England was England, and so I thought, the way I'd been brought up, that the world revolved around England. We'd been taught, rule Britannia, Britannia rules the waves. Britons never, never, never shall be slaves. And British is best. Everything I, you know, pencils I wrote with, books I used, printed in England, made in England. So I thought, well, the world revolves around England, and I'm British, so the world should, of course, revolve around me. So I was very insular in my youth. I always think I was 20 then. Went to Holland and realized they didn't give a hoot whether you were English or not. They were Dutch, and their England didn't count for very much at all. They were a small island, and they had once been a great empire. They had defeated the British in some things. They had gone around the Cape, got the Dutch East Indies, and in fact had been at war with England for some of the time. So it was a big eye-opener to me. They spoke a different language, which I learned, and fell in love with a Dutchman and married him, Hans van der Graaf, who is still my husband, and a very brilliant engineer. And we got married, and then he decided that he would like to go to the United States because there was more opportunity for engineers there, and Holland was a small country. But in going to the embassy there and trying to find about immigration, he had to be on a waiting list. So in the meantime, he applied for and received a job to go to work with Tapline on the Trans-Arabian Aramco oil company in Beirut, Lebanon, and that he would go ahead and then I would join him later. And so shortly after we were married, he went to Lebanon and I lived with his mother in Holland, learned to speak Dutch more fluently, and since she didn't speak English. And waited to join him in Lebanon. Now Holland, at that time also, was still recovering from the war. So that was why we had not been able to get separate accommodations. A lot of Holland had been destroyed during the war, so there were no, not much housing. And so we had an apartment in his mother's house. And so I stayed there for a few months and then went on a boat around the Mediterranean to Beirut, Lebanon. So going around the Mediterranean was also wonderful. Stopped off in Greece, Italy, North America, and explored all those different coastal places. So my experience of different cultures was expanding quite a bit, and different peoples and different races and different religions. And then when I got to Lebanon, we had an apartment, and right down the street was a mosque, just a few paces away, and small mosque. I had not been exposed to Muslims before, and the Muslim religion. I'd been to places on the coast in Africa where there were Muslims, and seen people wearing their shadows or whatever, and different customs. I've been to Zanzibar. But this was living right among Muslims, Christians, and in fact right down the street. And so it was much more of an exposure. I was still very young, I was not that interested intellectually in religions, but I could hear the muezzin calling, I don't know how many times a day, but certainly far more often than people would be going to pray, several times a day. During Ramadan, I knew that there was fasting going on, and the Lebanon at that time was about 50% Christian, 50% Muslim, and everybody seemed to get on very well together. We, of course, were outsiders in a way. I didn't speak Arabic, but the lingua franca was French, because it had been, I think, a French colony or something, but most people spoke French. So, and I could speak enough to get around. But it was such a fascinating place to be, because, well, first I had just been in a very English environment. Then in Holland realized that England did not rule the whole world, and that it was, but now I'm coming, but it was basically a Christian country there. Now I'm coming to live in a country where it's 50% Muslim, 50% Christian. And the Christians were all different too. There were Maronite Christians, there were Druze, there were different kinds of, many different kinds of Christian sects that I've been used to. And people dressed differently. But there was no feeling of hostility, discrimination. I would go into the souks, the marketplace, to shop. And you would see Kurds, Kurdish women, and people there selling their vegetables and things. You would see Jewish people. You'd see all kinds of people milling around, bargaining. It was a very lively place. It was a very cosmopolitan, very exciting. You could get all kinds of food that you want. You got street vendors selling kibbeh and meats, especially lamb or things like that. You could you well, we could go to high-class restaurants and get frog's legs and, you know, exotic French cuisine. There was just about everything you could think of in the world. And sadly now, I don't know why, but that's been several. We were there in the early 50s. It was like that. Since then, there's been a lot of destruction, a lot of bombing. I hesitate to go back there again. And also right now, we're in 2010, and there seems to be a particularly, well, here in the United States, but maybe in other countries too, a real fear of Muslims, that they are about to annihilate us, or things like that, suspicion. There was no feeling of that there at all. And I have, since being here, I've been into the ashram out at Yogaville, Satchitananda Ashram here. And Swami Satchitananda's theory is that truth is one and paths are many, and that all the religions need to get together in harmony. So I have studied more about religion. And if you study Christianity in depth, you see a lot of violence. You see a lot of hatred and bitterness. So I'm a Christian, but so any religion has some of that. And so I'm very fearful that here in the United States that people are saying, well, all Muslims are terrorists, because that's not true. And the religion itself, and it's an ancient religion, it has the same roots through Abraham as a Christian religion. And it comes from the same part of the world. And there's no reason why we shouldn't live in harmony like that with Muslims and other religions, because to survive as a human race, we need to understand each other and to live together. But anyway, I digress. I don't want to be a preacher. But Lebanon was a wonderful place to be because of that rich society at that time. And maybe there were some things that were not perfect, but for us living there at that time, it was a rich, rich experience and in a beautiful place. And then when we came to the United States, we came here. I had a small child, baby. He was only a few months old. And so we came to the United States. And I thought, and my husband had come ahead of time because he got to get a job, and we settled in Syracuse first. And so as an English woman, I thought, well, I'm going to the United States. It's an English-speaking country, I won't have any problems at all. And so I got here, but the first thing I needed, because I had this baby and I'd come over on a plane, so I hadn't brought a lot of supplies. So the first thing I needed was a pram to push the baby around in. And soon I got a telephone hooked up. We were living in a house that had been divided up into small furnished apartments, and we were living in a furnished apartment there. And so I looked up in the phone book for a baby store and called them up, asked if they had prams. They didn't know what a pram was. I thought, well. So then I also needed nappies for the baby. And they'd never heard of nappies either. They said, nappies? And I said, are you a baby store? And I said, you know, nappies. No. didn't know what it was. So then I asked Mrs. McGuire, who was a woman who owned the house and lived there upstairs and rented out these apartments, and she gave me a Sears Roebuck catalog. And so I looked down there and I saw in the, you know, you could see the pictures and then you could see what they were, and I could see that a pram, what I called a pram, was called a baby carriage. And that nappies were called diapers. So then I thought, well, because I thought, at first I thought, what on earth do Americans do when their babies have to go to the bathroom? It just seemed so incredible that they didn't do the same thing that everybody else in the world did. So I slowly got used to the American way of doing things. There were several surprises that I had, because I remember seeing my first American football game. I've never seen anything like that before. Looked like giants on the field with these enormous shoulders, and I didn't realize they had shoulder pads under there, that there was all that equipment. I thought that I'd almost come to another planet, and yet I expected to be, because I was English, of course, I expected everything to be the way I thought it was. And also, I had read about America. I'd read Life magazine and stuff like that. But in Life magazine, in those days, you never saw pictures of black people. And even though I'd learned some history and knew something about there had been slavery and the slave trade, I never, you know, I just never saw anything about American black folk in the national press, international press. So in Syracuse, you never really saw black people up there. Now, whether they were all ghetto, in a ghetto or something, I'm not sure. And, or whether there were very few. So it wasn't until I came to Lynchburg that I realized that there were a large population of black people in the United States. So I was very ignorant about that, about American history, period. I didn't know very much about American history, except what I had read in the British history books, which was very little, except that America had been a colony, and Queen Elizabeth had done, and tobacco, and Sir Walter Raleigh, and a few things like that. And then after America got its independence, nothing. I never learned anything much about America at all, except what I read and saw in the Life magazine and things like that. So it was a learning experience. And coming down here to Virginia. We came down here after 2 years up in Syracuse, less than 2 years. I had two children and two more very quickly afterwards. And saw that there was a black population here. And but then realized how differently the blacks were treated here than they were in Africa, or in Europe, or in other countries. Meeting black folk on the street, and this was back when we first arrived here in 1959, I found they would not look me in the face when they spoke. They had mostly their head turned down, their eyes turned down to the road, and I thought that was very strange. There were, even though I knew Lynchburg had a large population of black folk, there were no pictures of black folk, and you would get catalogs, you would not see any black faces in there. On the TV, you hardly saw any black faces on the news or anything. And it was very, very perplexing. And so the people I met, you know, saw the black people here in the South, mainly as servants, as yardmen, as laborers, and didn't even seem to treat them as human beings, you know, one-on-one. It was different in the other countries I had been to. And so I was trying to absorb all this, and that's how I got involved in this. And I'm into civil rights and a greater awareness of the terrible injustice that has been inflicted on African Americans here in this country. And as I got to know more of the African Americans, realized, well, yes, there are some who are servants and people like that, but they're also extremely cultured, very intelligent people. They're people like Anne Spencer, the poet, incredible. You know, I worked with Garnell Stamps in establishing, and Chauncey Spencer, her son, in establishing the Anne Spencer Foundation. And through that, and through working with the Lynchburg Community Action Group, with Reverend Haywood Robinson, realized the rich breadth of the African-American culture here. And so I'm very thankful that Angel is doing this movie to, well, in a way to commemorate or to record the stories of some of the people who are represented on my painting, Lord, Plant My Feet on Higher Ground. I particularly like to think of Dr. William Quilliam, Bill Quilliam, who was president of Randolph-Macon Women's College. And during the time of integration and change, who had the courage to stand up and push for integration, even though the members of his board objected, wrote letters to him, and probably telephoned him or even personally confronted him. I know particularly there were members of the Alumni Association from Lynchburg who came to him objecting to the fact that he allowed the students to work with African-American students in the lunch counter sit-ins. And he spoke that he was interviewed along with Dr. Ralph Rebus, who at that time, during the sit-ins in 1962, was a student at the Virginia Seminary and College, which is now the Virginia University of Lynchburg, and Dr. Langsford Hankins. That is a very significant interview. She also interviewed Mary Payne, who was a did work with voter registration and a lot of other work in civil rights, and for that she sort of lost her job with the shoe company she was working at, but then became a nurse. And she continues to work, even, and she is on the painting, and she was interviewed along with W.A. Clark, who was a science teacher, chemistry teacher at Dunbar High School, but had also experienced being in the armed services. And Robert Goins, known as Mad Lad, and he is significant because when he was only 15, he, at the time when I knew him in the early 60s, when the newspaper did not publish any news about African Americans, when the local radio stations did not broadcast much black, so-called black music, he set up as a child in his basement. He set up a bootleg radio station that he put together and was on the air. And he not only provided people in the city here with the current black music, but also he put on the news of where the meetings would be for the civil rights meetings, and also news of their sports events, and also promoted some political things. Then she also invited Walter Foer and Kenneth Oglesby, who were young people, young black men at that time, who started the Black Moses group. It was hard for African Americans at that time. So many images in the wider community were negative about blacks. Everything to put them down, keep them in their place. And so this feeling of black pride, and they felt that Black Moses, that every year they would put on the Black Liberation Day at the park, and there would be a big gathering of folk who would get together and do positive things for the black community and raise consciousness. And also that she has interviewed on this film, Willie Thornhill, who when she came from New York with her husband, then husband, Jim Young, who was a contractor. And he did a great deal to encourage black entrepreneurs, and particularly in the contracting business. He exposed, he brought suit against the city, the Redevelopment Housing Authority for discrimination. There were also a lot of instances where banks and other institutions in here would not open bidding to blacks for contracts. And once the federal law has been passed, then they had to comply, but a lot were trying to circumvent those laws. And Willie herself has done quite a lot. She was had a degree in nursing, was a supervisory nursing position in the public health department, and she did several pioneering things. And not to forget, Garnell Stamps, a community activist. And Garnell has throughout his whole career been a protagonist for justice and freedom for everybody. He was an outstanding example of somebody who put of great courage, who spoke up without concern for a cost to himself, and has helped this city move forward in civil rights. That's it.